when logicians talk about contradictions, they mean claims of the form that something is the case and it's not the case. So I'm in New York, I'm not in New York, the sun's shining, it's not shining, three is a prime number, but it's not a prime number, that kind of thing. And when we meet something like that, mostly our reaction is, hey, that can't be right. So we're dealing with something called the principle of non-contradiction or the law of non-contradiction. And roughly formulated, that's the view that a contradiction can't be true. You can't accept a contradiction. And it has to be said that that principle is high orthodoxy in Western philosophy. Its status in Eastern philosophy is somewhat different, but let's just stick to the West. Aristotle enunciates and defends law in the Metaphysics, and it's clear that he's attacking some people who he thinks accept some contradictions. So for him, it's a live issue, but he gives a bunch of arguments in favor of the law, and those really determine the ethos of Western philosophy on this topic. With very few exceptions, Western philosophers have endorsed the law. It's not because the arguments are very good. Some of them are so tangled, it's actually hard to tell what they are. And indeed, modern scholarship on that bit of the Metaphysics, there's a rough consensus that these arguments don't really fly. As all positions in philosophy, you have to make a case for it. And that's what philosophers who've been doubting the law of non-contradiction have been doing in the last 30 or 40 years, making the case. An important part of the case is to use examples, but another part of the case is to show how these examples aren't really susceptible to other treatments. So, let me give you an example. There's a paradox called the liar paradox, which is actually very old. It goes back to Eubulides, 5th century before the Common Era. Suppose I say, this very thing I'm telling you now is false. And you say, well, is that true or false? Well, if it's true, it says this very thing I'm telling you now is false. So if it's true, it's false. Hey, but if it's false, well then, I've just said that, so it's true. So it seems to be true and false. This is the liar paradox, right? To many people who have never seen this sort of stuff before, it can certainly appear like a party trick. It's never been treated that way by philosophers and logicians, and it has a remarkable history that at the beginning of the 20th century, it was discovered that this was one of a family of paradoxes that turned up in the foundations of mathematics. So what you say about this paradox is entrenched in hard questions in mathematics, but people have tried to analyze this paradox for, well, 2,500 years and explain why the conclusion doesn't follow. And their success has been minimal. There are thousands of solutions in both contemporary logic and medieval logic and ancient logic, and they've all got obvious problems. So the only thing there's consensus about is that there's no consensus. One thing that some modern logicians such as myself say is, hey, look at this paradox. We've been trying to say what's wrong with it. We've been barking up the wrong tree. What we should be doing is just accepting the conclusion. Other ways of trying to defuse the contradiction don't have a very successful track record. So the thought is, hey, we're better off just to accept the contradiction. Take the contradiction that I'm both in New York, sitting here talking to you, and not in New York, because I'm in Australia. That doesn't sound very plausible. So the next question that anyone's going to ask about this is, well, how do you know which ones? Good. And the answer to that is, how do you know that anything's true? You look at the evidence, right? So Hume said that the wise person is one who apportions their beliefs according to the evidence. Now, there's just no evidence that I'm not in New York. That's why it's crazy to believe it. But the liar paradox is different because we've got first order evidence. Here's the argument. We've got second order evidence. Hey, attempts getting out of this argument haven't been very successful for 2,000 years. So again, you look at the evidence. My view about these matters is unorthodox in terms of contemporary logic and philosophy. There are very few logicians who agree with this. There are more now than there were 30 years ago. In the early years when we were talking about this stuff, it was regarded as completely off the table. people like myself were regarded as just not worth taking seriously, not worth talking about, just because it's Looney Tunes stuff. Now that the attitude is changing, people realise that the law of non-contradiction is not so easy to defend. After we've hammered through so many of the philosophical and logical issues for the last 30 years, people have come to realise that the issues were not as simple as they thought. So people are prepared to engage with the issues now in a way they weren't 30 years ago. So my position in the establishment is of a bit of a heretic, but not a complete fruitcake.